In Pit Lane is proudly brought to you by Dynotech by Dyno Dynamics. For your nearest workshop, visit our website. And with the support of the Ramada Resort, Phillip Island. Welcome back to In Pit Lane. Well, coming up, as we said, this weekend out at Sandown is the traditional warm-up for the Bathurst 1000. It is the Sandown 500, one of the biggest events, probably outside of the Grand Prix. It's the biggest motorsport event in Victoria all year. Joining us tonight on the program, well, one man who has driven at Sandown in many, many occasions over the years. He is Stephen Richards, and he'll be driving not just in the Sandown 500, but also, as we said, in his regular Carrera Cup drive as well. Also joining him is a man who will be driving for the first time in the Sandown 500. He's come all the way from Sweden, where he is now with Gary Rogers Motorsport, driving the incredibly successful Volvo in this year's championship. He is Robert Dahlgren. Gentlemen, welcome to In Pit Lane.
Hi, Brett. How you going?
Well, before we get on to the subject of Sandown on the weekend, we saw through the news there. Let's talk a bit about Formula One and all the kerfuffle. I mean, you've seen the races. I mean, Steve, from your point of view, a lot of controversy about, did Nico Rosberg deliberately drive off the track on purpose to hand it? What was your take on it?
Oh, look, I don't know about that. I don't think anyone purposely does that sort of thing. He was getting put under a bit of pressure from Lewis, and, you know, he made a mistake. Clearly, he was a fair bit deeper, fair bit deeper than Lewis under brakes, and paid the consequence.
But Robert, looking at it from your point of view, I mean, going back to the original problem they had at Spa together, Nico, I mean, seems to be incredibly depressed and chastened about that. I mean, does he need to be? I mean, it was just a racing incident, surely. Surely it should be all over and done with now.
Yeah, it's difficult because I reckon within the team, they have been working together for a long time. They've been, you know, teammates from karting, and they've gone all through the career. They always stayed together and worked together. But it must have been a bit of a glitch in between them. They don't seem to work that well together. So it seems to be like two teams in one. And when that things happen, it doesn't just get a friction in between the drivers, but also within the team. So it's quite, I think it's quite interesting battle. And also what happened, last weekend, they seem to have a bit of a braking problem as well. They had that with Lewis in the past as well. So I don't really know what happened, but it will be very interesting in the coming races, definitely.
Well, it certainly made Formula One a lot more interesting this year, isn't it? As we said last week on the show, we've forgotten all about the ugly noses and the sound and all this, but now we're just watching good racing, and that's what it's all about, isn't it?
Well, I think, you know, there's been a couple of things. Obviously, anyone with a Mercedes engine has been pretty dominant, but then in the background there you've had Daniel Ricciardo, who's really come from, well, not nowhere, but nowhere in terms of exceeding everyone's expectations. I think, you know, he just this year hasn't put a foot wrong. It's amazing for a guy to jump into a team with his teammate that's a four-time world champion or whatever he is, five-time or whatever it is. He's just doing an incredible job.
Also, we saw during the news, coming up this weekend is the opening round of Formula E, the all-electric racing series. These of you guys, are you all excited? You all hanging out to see Formula E in action?
No.
I think that sums it up, really, doesn't it?
Grass growing and paint walls drying, that sort of brings up Formula E for me.
But the thing is, I mean, they're obviously they're spending a fortune on this. I mean, you know, the whole of the FIA, the World Council will be there, John Todt will be there. They're really spending an awful lot of time and money. We've got some great drivers there wallowing around in these cars. I mean, does it frustrate you when you think of what this money could be doing for other forms of motorsport?
Well, I think, you know, there has to be a perception as to where motor racing is heading, and you know, we've seen this year with Formula One, the relevance of the hybrid technology that they're using now is really looking 10 years into the future. So I guess, you know, moving further beyond that, we're going to have electric cars at some point. And if that's the case, we're probably going to be racing them. and where does that head? So I guess Formula E is an extension of what that is, and then moving forward beyond, hopefully they get a bit quicker.
I suppose that's the thing. This is the first race, the first year. I mean, Robert, do you see an all-electric racing car in your future?
Yeah, probably I've stopped by the time that comes on. But, I mean, end of the day, it needs to be good racing. If it comes from electric cars, it's one thing, and probably will be, like I say, will be the future. But it needs to be good racing, as simple as that. And I'm a bit worried about the sound as well. All the categories in Europe, they have brought that down, the sound, massively. Mm. V8 is one of the few that still has that great sound. I mean, just at the Grand Prix here in Melbourne, I was stunned seeing that actually Formula Ones were out, but I couldn't hear them. It was they disappeared. And that's a bit worrying. And that gets the talk. I mean, it's such a great racing in Formula One now. It's probably one of the best we've seen in many, many years. But without the sand, that's something they really need to solve.
And when you think about it, this is the first year of these new regulations. I've been surprised how reliable the cars have been overall as well. But when you consider that Honda are coming back in next year and Renault will have another year to try and hopefully catch up on Mercedes, the future is looking really good.
Well, I think it is. They're getting more interest back in. There's no question that the new regulations are more relevant to the automotive industry moving forward. So I guess then it gives the big guys, the big car manufacturers out there, reason to be involved in Formula One, because they are actually trying to utilise technology. And we've seen it with Mercedes this year. The way that they've developed that engine is incredible.
And they've already said that, you know, the direct technology they're now using in that engine will be in your road Mercedes probably by next year.
Yep.
Robert, let's talk about you personally at the moment. I mean, you know, probably this time last year, you weren't even thinking that you were going to be sitting, you know, here getting ready to race in the Sandown 500. Tell us how it all happened. I mean, when did you get the approach to come over here and start the great adventure?
Yeah, that's. I don't really know the answer to that fully, I think, but I try what I know. I went over here, I think it was in June, and that was actually to introduce a new car that I've been a part of developing through Polestar, an US60. And we started to discuss that and, you know, just talked about the championship when we were here. But not as me coming into the championship, but just so it's a fantastic championship. We need to, you know, something we need to look at and see what they do right, because something they always do right, we need to bring back to Europe. And we just start talking. And after a while, I just got a phone call and said, would you be interested in going over to Australia and race? And I said, yes.
I suppose the big question is, you were interested, but what did the wife say?
Oh, yeah, that's a good question. Yeah, she said, actually, blank no to that one. And she said, no, we've travelled enough. I mean, I brought them everywhere. I have two kids now, so yeah, it's a bit of a tall order to ask her to go here. But I sold in that it's always between 20 and 30 degrees, always in Australia, and always sunny. And I brought up, look how warm it is, you know, I brought up Darwin.
Yeah.
I didn't say anything about moving to Melbourne, but yeah, that came up a little bit later and she
said... Didn't mention crocodiles.
No, I didn't mention that either, no.
No, we'll find out a bit more about those adventures, because it is a fascinating thing to come all this way and be a part of a whole new racing series in a whole new country. We'll also prove you what's happening this weekend out at Sandown. You're watching In Pit Lane. We're going to take a break now, but we'll be right back with our guests, Steve Richards and Robert Dalgren, right after this break.
More power, better fuel economy, a cleaner, more efficient engine. They're just a few of the advantages of having your car tuned on a Dynotech dyno. To find your nearest Dynotech workshop, go to dyno.com.au. Dynotech by Dyno Dynamics.
Welcome back to In Pit Lane. Our guests tonight, Stephen Richards and Robert Dalgren, both competing in the Sandown 500 this weekend. Steve, you're competing in the 500, but you're also competing in the Carrera Cup. How difficult is that in juggling those two different sorts of cars and that time?
In actual fact, the driving the cars is the easy bit. It's the running in between and coordinating all the bits that we have to do. I mean, to be honest, the Carrera Cup, while mentally it doesn't take a backward step, the importance of the 500 kilometre race is such that, you know, basically I leave all of my Carrera Cup driving overalls in the Red Bull Transporter and then just do the do the Superman in the phone box routine in there. So, look, it has its challenges. We've got, very lucky I've got good people in my Carrera Cup team that look after all aspects of the car and organisation, and my wife runs with me from one place to another to make sure I'm on time.
You've been with Ford Performance Racing for a long time, and suddenly you've now moved to 888. How did that all come about? Why the move?
Oh, look, I had 7 fantastic years at FBR as a full-time driver and then as an enduro driver, and I just thought that probably and possibly, the Bathurst win last year, it almost closed the door on that chapter for me, I think. And I'm the sort of person that I don't like stagnating and standing still. I think if you get set in the same routines, you can sometimes take things for granted, and I just needed a new challenge. So I was very, very lucky to be able to join forces with Craig and Red Bull Racing.
Robert, this is of course your first time out at Sandown, and your first time in the 500 driving with Greg Ritter. Having a look at Sandown, I mean, have you had an opportunity to drive around in anything, or will this Friday be your first time out on the track?
Yeah, first time out on Friday, unfortunately. Yeah, it'll be interesting. I've looked at all the, all the footage and, realised it's a very, very long race.
Some good straights for that powerful engine of yours,
yeah,
too.
Yeah, it will actually be pretty good.
Well, you've done lots and lots of laps over the years in various things. In fact, you're your current GT lap record holder. Mm-hmm. I mean, what tips? I mean, if Robert was asking, I mean, I know he's competition and all that, but if you're being very friendly and, in the spirit of, hands across the ocean and all that crap, I mean, what advice would you be giving him about getting around Sandown quickly?
Brake later and accelerate earlier.
Oh, yeah. Thank you for that one.
Yeah, he'll send you the bill later, too. Yeah. So, how have you found the V8 supercars? We've had a lot of European drivers over the years who have done, people like Alain Menu and Mauro Engel, a lot of people who are top-class drivers like overseas, and they've all said that V8 supercars are really a different beast altogether. How difficult are they to drive?
It is. I was a bit almost shocked or taken by how different that car was. I mean, I've been in a lot of different cars, and basically, if you take Europe, goes a totally different way. They go lighter and lighter cars and more downforce and using the diff to tune the car in slow speed corners and the aero in high speed. And this is just very, very different. So you need to, I probably haven't figured out how to drive it fast enough, obviously. Otherwise, I would have been at the front. But it's very, very different. They move about a lot. It's like almost driving a bus. It just, you brake and you feels like you're falling over the front and accelerate and you just see sky. It's a little bit like that.
That was Alain Menu's thing when he spoke to us. The word he was looking for, I think, was agricultural. But what he said was, they are like tractors, fast tractors, fun tractors, but tractors.
No, they are. I mean, they are amazing cars and. Don't get me wrong, it's just that movement between when you brake and you're turning into the corner, you need to do it absolutely 100% right. Otherwise, you just, because then the power application, everything is just, it needs to be that timing needs to be so right, almost more precise than any car I've been driving in the past. So even though they're big and moving about a lot, they're actually asking a lot more from the driver in certain ways.
With the this is obviously the lead up to Bathurst. How much are you looking forward to getting out onto the mountain and testing Bathurst for the first time?
Yeah, that's one of them. You want to tick it, the box. It's just, I've been around a couple of great tracks, but that one I haven't been around. And with all the talk, and I think the first day I actually arrived, I got the question, like, have you been around Bathurst? I thought, all right, yeah, it must be something special.
I seem to remember the first time you arrived, when you were at least presented to the media for the first time, was fairly early in the year, and you'd come from a Swedish winter, and I think it was about 43 degrees when you turned up. I mean, that would have been a hell of a culture shock.
It was actually. The week before, I picked up my daughter from daycare on a snowmobile, and it was about minus 18. And then just, so when I actually, the day I left, it was minus 16 and arrived, and it was like, I don't know, 38 or whatever it was. It was like, couldn't believe it. I thought it was a great idea to go out for a run Albert Park. I thought, great, I live near the track, I go there for a run, so I do a 10K run, I take it a bit easy. I thought I was going to, you know, after about 5K, it was 38 plus.
At least you could have jumped in.
I didn't think about that, but I was worried about the crocodiles and that.
I think you'd have probably been safer out in the running around into the heat stroke. What's your, I suppose, Steve, once again, in terms of the advice around Bathurst, your advice would be watch out for kangaroos.
Yeah, well, I mean, Bathurst is a, you know, it's one of those unbelievable places in the world that, you know, as racing car drivers, you know, we aspire to drive at those circuits that give us huge challenges. And, you know, as well as the circuit itself, you've got other things like the wildlife and bits and pieces. And the race too, it's a sprint race. It really is. It's like going and doing a 45-minute 100K race in a supercar, except you're going for 6.5 hours. So lots of other elements come into play, but it's a good place.
Robert, this is of course your first year. What's your deal with Gary Rogers Motorsport? Are you is it just for this year, or are you looking to extend for next year as well?
We haven't even started talking about that. I have a deal. I have had a deal with Volvo for a long time, and that's what was one of the big reasons why I came here, because I've been a part of developing all the race cars that Volvo have come up with the last couple of years. So that was the main focus, and be the link in between Volvo and Polestar back in Sweden. And that has worked really well. I don't know where they want to place me. So Gary is obviously a big part, but Volvo as well. So yeah, I'm a bit of the little thing on the board. They move around. So yeah, we'll see what happens in the future.
Well, you've got an advantage over every other, because you're probably the only V8 supercar driver running around at the moment who can speak Swedish. So it's probably a pretty good advantage. Unless, Steve, you want to do a quick Duolingo sort of.
No, I'm too old for that.
Look, well, guys, good luck on the weekend in all your endeavours, both with the Sandown 500 and Steve with you with the Carrera Cup. Good luck at Bathurst as well. Robert, great to meet you for the first time. Steve, thanks for joining us once again, and we'll see you again hopefully one day here on In Pit Lane. But for now, thanks for joining us.
Thank you very much.
And thank you to you at home. Now remember, coming up right after the program at 10:30, if you go to the In Pit Lane YouTube channel, we have our Google Hangout, the Victory Lap. It's happening live. You can just, if you want to get involved in the conversation, the hashtag is the Victory Lap. You can do that on Twitter or Google+. But right now, next week on the program, our special guest, well, we've got a couple of people lined up, but one of the people coming in to preview the big Shannon's Nationals meeting out at Phillip Island will be young sports Dan and Formula 4 driver Thomas Randall. That's next week on In Pit Lane, same time, 10 o'clock here on Channel 31. But until we see you next week, from all of us here, bye for now.